Even today, Edith Wharton occupies a place as one of America's leading literary ladies. She was born into the upper crust of old New York in the mid-1800s, a member of high society who also exposed it through the prism of her pen. Wharton wrote more than 40 books in 40 years, including Ethan Frome and The Age of Innocence, for which she became the first woman awarded the Pulitzer Prize for fiction. Today, she is also remembered for her home, The Mount. And if ever a house could serve as an autobiography, The Mount is it. Situated on a hill overlooking a lake in Lenox, Massachusetts, The Mount was conceived by the writer from the ground up. She dreamed its location, guided its aesthetic principles, and designed her elaborate gardens. It was, in a sense, her own house of mirth, which she wrote while living here.
This house was an opportunity for her to really do things the way she thought they ought to be done, and that was to really champion a return of classicism, symmetry, balance, proportion, lots of light, and really opening up spaces, and to make them livable.
We spoke with The Mount's Kelsey Mullen in Wharton's drawing room. The house's largest room when it was built in 1902, she used it to entertain frequent guests like fellow writer Henry James.
They were very, very good friends, and she matched him in literary skill, I think, towards the end.
Wharton designed her home practically. No space went unused. It was large, but not grand, and it favored her predilection for privacy. Despite carefully crafted images of Wharton as a writer staged in her library, she actually wrote elsewhere.
Edith Wharton had always done her best work writing in bed. That was where the creative genius inspired her. And so I think in building The Mount, she created a space where she could have the privacy she needed to get her best work done.
She did love her library, though, and a full two-thirds of her collection has been returned to The Mount.
What does her library tell us about her?
It's been a remarkable window into Edith Wharton's intellectual life. She was reading across genres, really a voracious learner, and she was reading in five different languages, sometimes ancient Norse when she was feeling up for a challenge. She was reading books on astronomy and theology.
Her books are riddled with marks, notations, and destruction. Dismayed with one publisher's choice to feature illustrations in one of her books, she found a remedy.
In her own copy of The House of Mirth, you can see on the title page, she has crossed out the name of the illustrator in pencil, and then all of the illustrations have been razored out of the book.
Amazingly, Wharton considered herself a better landscape gardener than novelist, although that's slightly less astonishing when you see her gardens, which, fully recreated, appear as Wharton saw them.
She built the garden in stages as she was receiving advances from her books. And it was during that time that she's taking these European ideas and placing them in an American context and fitting together a French garden with an Italian garden and an English lime walk all on the shores of a Massachusetts lake.
All of this is a welcome second chapter to The Mount's history. Threatened with foreclosure just 5 years ago, the home has managed to climb out of its fiscal hole and is now running in the black. A footing regained, today The Mount is positioning itself as the Berkshire's literary hub, drawing the attention of writers the world over. Its champions also include former First Lady Laura Bush, who first fell in love with Ethan Frome as a West Texas schoolgirl.
People read Wharton and realize that, in fact, while a lot has changed, a lot is still very much the same. And she just is so clean and muscular in the way that she sort of expresses it and observes it that her writing is as relevant today as it ever was.
Meaning this is Edith Wharton's renewed age of resonance.